How is your practice going today? How is your practice going today? How is your spiritual path going today? Right? That's the question. For me, it's going great. I'm here out in California, Bay Area, and we're outside here in a little our taping area, and it's big storm is raging, lot of wind, some heavy rain, steady rain, sometimes heavy, right in the middle of it here. So it's morning time, and I already have had tremendous spiritual practice today. Starting out in the morning and being able to get on a real good run, very profound run. And this is what you want in your day. You want to get on this wave, surf the wave of wow. Surf the wave of wow. And I was able to do my full stop in the wow practice and get it more and more clarified. We're doing a full stop in the wow intensive at this point, 1 year intensive. And it's all about this practice. It's not about anything else. And I will adjust this a little bit. I love the background colors, right? But it's a little. It's going to knock out. This is going to knock out some of the, there you go. Some of the brightness. But its brightness is nice. It's all about the practice. Now, great clarification this morning about this practice we do. A little bit of background. Homage to the Dharma Kings who have our backs and see us as valuable assets and are helping us out in every way. Ramana Maharshi is one of the Dharma Kings. And in around the year 2000, I had this dream where I've recounted this many times, and in this dream, he came up to me of his own volition and said, look, I have something I want to tell you. He conveyed, he told me, the kind of practice that you're aiming towards and developing and working on, he says, that's just as good as what I'm doing. It's really ultimately the same. It's just a different style. And I said, I want you to keep doing it. Don't try to do the I inquiry, okay? So he gave me direct permission not to do the I inquiry, but to do what ultimately has turned out to be the full stop in the wow practice. And this morning I recognize, oh my gosh, I recognize that the I inquiry is just I. Everything back to just I. It's exactly the same as ours, as everything just back to wow. Exact same principle and practice. We're just using a different label for it. And the reason for this is that for those who are oriented more towards beauty, sublime, the sublime and beauty, like myself, and not so much towards socialization and people, the wow practice is the right practice. For those who are oriented more towards social relations with people, social interactions and relationships with people, seeing that that is their main focus, that's what they're really focused on, the I inquiry is the right inquiry. The I inquiry practice is the right practice. So this became very clear, and I said, oh, wow. Because I've never been a social person, never interested in social interaction. But I'm super interested in beauty and sublime beauty, creativity, you know, just that which lifts us into the abstract, the sublime. That's always been what I'm, you know, really, really focused on. And so my reactions, I'm always looking for the wow. Like, wow, look at that. Oh, wow. Wow, 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 wow. Wow, what a great insight. Wow, what a great recognition. I love this, you know, the beauty of it. And so there's these different types in the world. And so you can ask yourself, am I more like of a social type? I love interacting with people and being in groups of people, doing things with people. I love family. I love children. I just love the whole, you know, human interaction thing, if that's the way you are, then the I inquiry is the right path to go on. It's just, as soon as the mind starts to wander, like clouds forming, they liken our thoughts to like cloud forms forming, as they form, then they kind of wander off and change shape, and that's the way our thinking goes. You say, okay, all this thought about interaction, it's just I. And bring yourself right back to I, and just relentlessly block all other thoughts, all this wandering cloud, all these clouds. Let them wander, but you just stay I. So if that's, now, but if your orientation is more towards, people, you know, not really that interested in people. I'd rather look out upon a beautiful ocean and a coastline and the waves and just kind of in the overall vibe of everything and just say, oh, wow, this is just beautiful, just beautiful. If beauty is your thing, right, then wow is the right practice for you, where every conclusion is just wow. We just stick to the one conclusion for everything, just wow. So as these cloud forms of thoughts, these cloud thought forms begin to form in the sky of our awareness, of our attention, and they begin to form, they begin to move this direction and that direction, as always, we just say, we're not interested in any conclusions that they're trying to reach. We already have our conclusion. It's wow. It's just wow. And so we just stay centered in this total overall response. Ultimate conclusion is just wow. That's the conclusion. We already have it. And so we just stay wow. So Ramana was right. 15, 16, 17 years ago. He was right. And I trusted him. I trusted him. He's so benevolent. His benevolence was so strong. I said, I'm going to trust in this, and I'm going to continue working on this wow practice, towards this practice. At that time, I didn't have the wow practice, but it was emerging. I knew there was something that I was aiming for. Very, very important. He said, it's very important. I said, you have to keep. You have to persevere here. It's very important. Very windy. Gusty. Wow. Wow. There you go. Wow. Eddie. So, I'd rather be out looking, watching the storm than talking with people. You know, I don't like talking with people, actually. And you may be that way, too. You may say, I'd rather just be seeing something really beautiful than talking with someone. I really don't get anything out of talking with people. Whereas others just love to talk with people. You know, they live for social interaction of talk. I don't live for that at all. In fact, I try to avoid it at all costs. So I like just to be immersed in this wow atmosphere. Just a beautiful atmosphere, surroundings, everything is just so serene and gorgeous and lush and beautiful. And forget all about bodies and people and civilizations and all of that. It doesn't interest me. But there are many like this. There are many. This is a type. These are two basic types there are. Other people would love to sit in a coffee shop all day chatting and laughing and chatting about mundane stuff and gossiping, you know, just hanging out with people, visiting. They live for that. Me, not at all. Not at all. More of an artistic, creative type. Beauty type, interested in the sublime beauty. So there you go, there you have it. Same practice, but with different temperaments in mind. So we don't need to try and combine both practices. That would be an absurdity, wouldn't it? Because the whole idea of these practices are different temperaments are suited to different emphasis on the conclusion. One is the conclusion is I, the conclusion is wow. And we've just assumed all along that it's just the I thing is it for everybody. It's not true at all. It's not true at all. Those who are interested in people and interactions, socials, they think everybody's that way. Not true. Because those who aren't that way avoid the social interaction. They're not into that. And so that those who are into it not even aware of us. You know, they don't even know we exist. They just assume that everyone's just like them. No. There's so many people who'd rather be, you know, hiking through the woods or you know, just doing something that is just, they're just like, oh my gosh, that's so beautiful, that's so beautiful, that's so beautiful. And you know if one predominates in you or not. You know. And we're not trying to balance that out, because then that balanced out would also need a practice, you know. All of that is a waste of time. Like, I need to be equally this and that. If you're equally sociable and equally into beauty, then you'd need a practice suitable for that. You can't escape practice, in other words. If we believe that, if we just balance stuff out, we'll escape practice, that's absurdity. That's absurdity. The whole thing is to have just one conclusion for everything. One conclusion. So if you're balanced between sociability and sublimity, you will need a style that simply draws one conclusion for you. You're comfortable with just that one conclusion. So you still have to practice just as much as anyone else. So you see, there's no escaping practice. We spend all our time trying to escape practicing in this world, don't we? Trying to escape it. It's true. I'll just make an adjustment and then I won't have to do the I inquiry. Well, do the wow. Okay, I'll make another adjustment and I won't have to do either the I or the wow. Well, then do the one that's suitable for your adjustment. Well, now I'll make another adjustment and that one's not suitable for me. You know, we just keep avoid. And it's all to nothing, all to no profit at all. We still have to do the practice because it's essential that we be able to rest in one conclusion. Why is it so essential? Let me see if this is recording. I'm having problems with the headphones again. It's just an ongoing issue. So let me see if it's recording on both channels or just one. It's both. Okay. That's great. Wonderful. So everything's working right now. It may not work in the future. So for me, it's the wow. Okay. I'm not teaching the I inquiry. Don't ask. At this point, I'm still practicing. So I have to keep practicing what works for me. And encourage others who are attuned to beauty and artisticness and beauty and the sublime to practice the wow. Forget about the I. It's not going to be that helpful. It seems forced. But the wow, for me, the wow is just natural. Because I'm always in the wow anyway. I'm always seeking the wow anyway. Today I'd like to go somewhere, but I'm not going to because it is really windy and stormy, and they say there'll be flooding. The weather hypers say there's going to be flooding. They're not weather forecasters. They're weather hypers. There's no weather forecasters anymore. They're all weather hypers. So the first they said this about almost, 5 to 6 inches of rain here. And then they kept whittling it down as it got into the event. They kept downgrading it. So they hype it up first and then try to downgrade. Well, maybe, only 4 inches. Now it's like, three. Supposed to be like 2.5 inches of rain. And today, now it's like maybe, it's down to like 1 point something. So they always hype it. They always hype, and they're weather hypers. It's a world of hype right now. Tabloid world. Wow. So the wow practice, the one conclusion practice, we can say, whether it's inquiry of I or wow, it blocks all other conclusions. Ramana says it block all other thoughts. The practice is to block all other thoughts. Meditation practice is one thought to the exclusion of all others. Okay, this is, he says, is true meditation. And for us, one thought, it's deeper than that. It's one conclusion. Okay, it's one conclusion. This is what should be emphasized. Not one thought, but one conclusion. Because thoughts are really just seeking for a conclusion. So if we want to block thoughts, choose a conclusion. Wow. That's the conclusion. For everything is wow. And hold on to that one conclusion. And then the thoughts will then just ultimately just dissipate and not arise anymore because you're not searching for any other conclusion. You have the conclusion. You already have the conclusion. Wow. You didn't arrive at it. You just chose it. You didn't use thinking to arrive at it. You chose it. Wow. You wowed it. You wowed the wow. So you put yourself as already there. You're already there with the wow. You already have the conclusion. It's your choice. You already have it. Now, why is this so important? Because ultimately, on the path, ultimately, we have to recognize something. The recognition has to become clear. So our clarity has to arise. We have to be very clear. And what our clarity will show us, what clarity shows us is, oh my gosh, wow. ultimately, it shows us there is no world. There's never been a world. Never been a world. That's only our imagination believing that such a thing is possible. But the recognition that clarity shows us is so wowish. You have to be able to still hold on to a conclusion. So you just say, wow, there's no world. Well, wow. Wow is my conclusion about this. So basically, wow is a substitute for world. Okay, wow is a substitute for world. So as we see, there is no world at all. When we may not understand what I'm saying about no world, but that will come. That will come on your path. You will recognize it. Then we say, well, my conclusion about this is wow. And so wow seems to be like, well, I still just have this wowness is kind of, it's a substitute. I don't have a world, but I have wow. I have a conclusion, wow. Like a security blanket. You will need this security blanket. You will need it. Very, 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 very unlikely that anybody is going to just directly see there is no world, never have been, never has been, etc., and abide in that recognition without backlash coming and continuity fear arising. And then getting swept out of the abidance. Okay, that's super, super, super unlikely for any one of us. Okay, so just keep that in mind, and don't gamble on a virtual certain loss. Okay, to gamble on a certain loss is really a state of denial. So we know that we need this security blanket. There's no question about it. And at some point, we give up our security blankets, but not for quite some time, right? We still want it around. It keeps our thoughts from reformulating, the search from reformulating, right? If we see there's no world, suddenly we get scared. We say, well, I got to go in search of a world then. And then the thoughts arise. There's really just a search for a world. There's no world. We just claim that this, what we're perceiving is a world. It's not. It's a search. It's just our desire to search for a world. There's no world at all. This is very clear to me this morning. It's becoming more and more clear, and it will become clear for you as well. We're not used to having this explained, because most spiritual teaching in this world is just icing on the cake of arrogance. It's just icing on the cake of arrogance is all it is. Most of it, because most of it stops short of recognizing there's no world. There's never been a world. no such thing can ever exist at all. There's only God. There's only God. So most stop short of that in actual practice, and they say that there is a world, you know, and there are, you know, humans of the world, or even if you say that's impermanence, it's still the notion that there is a world. You know, it most comes up short of no world at all. Theoretically, they may say like emptiness or impermanence or such and such, but to categorically, positively say there is no world at all, and realize that is absolutely your goal. Nothing less than that is the goal on the path. Nothing less than that. Have to recognize. Clarity has to shine upon this fact. Therefore, we have to prepare to be able to abide in this clarity. Well, clarity that shows there is no world. That's abidance. Spirit of abidance is the spirit of willing to abide in the recognition there's no world at all. Never has been. In fact, a world is impossible. So if we're not really grounded in the meditational practice of wow, reaching this, the wow conclusion is just, it's already reached. That's all there is. There's no thought to reach it. We don't need any thought process to reach wow. Wow is primal thought. It's primal, completely primal. Before all other thought arises, just wow. Okay? If we're not grounded in that, we are going to spin back into thinking when we see that there's no world. And then right away we're presuming that there is, and that there's a self, you know, it's the whole mess arises again. And this was really clear to me this morning. All of it was very clear. So trying to translate this into a video, I have to be careful and not try to do too much. So I saw that most religions and spirituality and non-spirituality and non-religions, all of this is taking as an assumption that there is a world. And this is totally false. So what they're doing is trying to put icing on the cake of their arrogance. That's it. Try to make the arrogance sweet, tastes good. But it never tastes good. Arrogance never tastes good. The belief in a world is always suffering. Our suffering comes because we believe in a world. Say, I am in a world. If there's no world, how can I be in a world? How can there be a world, an I, in relation to a world if there's no world? Obviously, that's not possible. There is a self. We have a self. It's just not a world self. It's not a self in relation to any world. So we don't have to get rid of the I or the self or anything. It's just we realize it's not in relation to any world at all. So the world self, the I in relation to a world self, there is no such identity at all, because there's no world. There's only God. Everything that we see, it's present, but it's the context that it's present in is the question. Is it present in a world, or is it present in God? The allness. It's present in the allness. And there's nothing but this allness. There's nothing but that. So we cannot delineate a world. Where would a world begin, and where would it end? There's no beginning or ending in God. So there's no way to define a world or delineate it, actually. But this is, you know, this is theory. What's more important is the practice. So I don't have a religion, I have a practice. So we're not teaching religion here. We're teaching practice, which is just wow practice, just wow. And again, it's either that, or basically it's either this or I inquiry. You know, I, just I. So the teaching of Ram Maharshi is so accurate, so spot on, in terms of his adamant insistence, you know, that you must do this, you must do this. He's absolutely right. Because he truly told us the truth, that there is no world at all. And yet he was still present. So it must mean that there is something. You know, it's God. The allness is God. God is present. So his presence is in God, just as our presence, all presence is God, in God, as God. There's nothing else. There's no world. There's no world presence at all. That's just a arrogant make-believe fantasy that we have. But this is just words. The truth is, you can see this. The clarity can illuminate this for you. And you can recognize it and say, oh, wow. Wow. And right away say, wow. And then don't draw any conclusions other than wow. So it's practice that works. It's not philosophizing. Philosophizing doesn't work. And philosophers die as philosophers, okay? And death is an attempt to prove there's a world, okay? That's all it is. Nothing, there's really no death at all. There's no world. You can't die, actually, because there's no world to die in. We claim we die, and then we say, well, there had to be a world then in order to die. But we don't really die at all. We're just pretending to die. Ananda Maimai would just die, or seem to die, and start rotting. All her flesh, you know, all the signs of the corpse would appear. She'd be dead, no heart, no pulse, breath, heartbeat, absolutely clinically dead, and then rotting. And then the people would have a change of mind and say, okay, we'll stop believing in a world. We'll listen to what you have to say. And then she'd just come back to life and be as fresh as a daisy, beautifully fresh, like the absolute picture of radiant health. There's no death. Just pretense. It's all pretense. It's just we keep are holding on to this pretense. They say, no, the body's dead. It's dissolved. It's buried. You know, and it's irreversible. You know, the world has, you know, consumed it. There's no world to consume anything. It's all pretense. It's all just appearance. But again, if you philosophize, you'll die. You'll pretend to die as a philosopher. Okay. Spiritual philosopher, secular philosopher, whatever. We don't philosophize, we practice. And not many do this. But ultimately, it's inescapable. It's ultimately inescapable. There's no world that you can escape God in, okay? There's no world where you can hide from God at all. We're just, think we're hiding from God. Say, God, I'm hiding from you in a world. And God says, what world? I don't see any world. There's no world. Oh, no, we're in a world, and we're dying in this world, and, you know, that's the proof there's a world, we're dying, and God says, I don't see any dying, I don't see any world, that's just your wishful thinking, is all. So in your practicing, which has to do with your own clarity, the clarity that arises within you, you must not philosophize about it. You must see it and say, wow. That's your conclusion. That's your philosophy. Your philosophy is one word. Wow. Now we're getting a steady rain. This is not like the El Nino storms that we had in several years. The streets would be flooded, running. I mean, the water now, it's just the gutters are just nicely flowing. There's no overrun or anything happening. So it's just kind of a steady rain right now. Not heavy, not real heavy rain. A steady rain. Occasional little bursts of stronger stuff, but not like a downpour. There's no downpour happening here. So they said downpour. No, not really. Maybe in the mountains it's raining a little heavier. That's possible. They say there'll be some flooding. And maybe there will be. Because that dream I had a while ago was all this flooding in residential areas. I still said, what? How's that possible? Because it didn't really flood that bad in El Nino. So I don't know. I doubt it's going to flood that bad. But you never know. Up in the mountains, it just might be absolutely pouring. And all that water is coming rushing down into the rivers here. And it may... They say there's a possibility it may flood into various neighborhoods. I can check the check various areas, but I'm not going to. It doesn't, it is what it is, and they're on top of that. The flood abatement experts are out there ready to go. Not really in a floodplain right here where I am. I imagine it's a little bit wild in the mountains. They're used to it up there. They like it. Rugged types. In search of a world. We're ruggedly living in a world. That's proof that we're in a world. Everything we're doing, we're trying to prove we're living in a world, and it's all much ado about nothing. There's no world. The whole body thing is us trying to prove that that there's a world. When we realize that there isn't any world, we don't need the body to die or get sick at all, or try to prove anything, really. We can just turn it into light if we want to, or just keep it the way it is if we want to. But again, those are conclusions. We don't want to go into that too much. Clarity will clarify everything. When you're able to handle the clarity by insisting, you already have the conclusion for this, which is, wow, blocking all thinking, all philosophizing, all attempts to put it into context of a world. Like, well, how do I relate that to a world? You're not. You're relating it to wow. So world substitutes for wow. And wow substitutes for world. So you either you believe in the world, you're using world as a mantra, or wow. One of the two. And in living here, in being present in this oneness that people keep insisting is a world, that's what I found is that those who are arrogant, they're always insisting world this, world. They're so obsessed with the world. And for me, I'd say, what are you talking about? There's not any world. We got to evolve the world. We're here to nurture the world. God so loved the world that He sent His only Son to die for the world. All this stuff. Those are world worshipers, which is really they're worshiping their own arrogance. They're trying to put icing on the cake of their arrogance. Is all they're interested in at this moment, and they thought Jesus was the icing to put on their arrogance. And He's not. He's not. He never was. He never was. So here everybody's thinking like, God made the world. God put us here in the world. The world is our home. There's no world. God doesn't make worlds. Worlds are impossible to make. It's impossible. Nothing could ever leave God. It's all God. Just God. There's no worlds at all, actually. Now we say that the pure lands, the pure realms, Well, there are realms where it's apparent that it's not other than God. You know, it's very easy to recognize, oh, it's just all God. We call it a realm, or the pure lands, where we're not trying to prove that there's a world. So it's just very, very wowish. Pure lands are very wowish. You could still say it's part of a dream. You could say that, which is fine. But from there, you realize there's no such thing as worlds at all, or realms at all. No, there's just the oneness that is God. That's the ultimate realization. But we are here chipping away at the notion of a world, and practicing wow, which is what works. It works. And the very fact that I've seen very clearly now, I'm able to get to recognizing there's no world at all. It's not that I got rid of a world. There's never been a world. The fact that we're trying to concentrate some appearances in an apparent location, we think it's in a location, and then defining that as a world doesn't mean that it's actually a world at all. It's everything is one smooth continuum. There's only the perfect continuum of God, intrinsic spaciousness. So what takes us out of abidance in God is the belief of in a world. So those who are trying to triumph over evil, they're saying that these people are threatening, evil is threatening my world, or threatening my belief in a world, that I have to defeat them. And that the belief in the Messiah is to come in and defeat those who don't recognize our world, you know? Because when you believe in a world, you automatically project the fact that there is no world. You know that within you. You then project it out onto others, believe in otherness, and it feels a threat. Something's threatening your world now. So you feel you have a world, but it's under threat. But the threat is really just the fact that there is no world in the first place. So immediately we project threat. As soon as we believe in a world, the threat of the fact there is no world, gets turned into a threat, and then we become fearful of that threat, and then we attach that threat to something that is needs to be defeated. And so then you have enemies. Now, why do I make videos like this? Because, at least this is how I see it at this point, is that the idea of just condensing all this down into just, 5 minutes of real direct teaching, that's just flattering our philosophizing, actually. We think, oh, I'm such a great philosopher, I can understand that, I got it. Now I got that as my philosophy. And it doesn't work that way. We need to be much more sociable with our wowness, so to speak. Not with people, but with our own clarity. We need to be sociable with our clarity. Okay, sociable with our clarity. And have this easement with it, and just get used to just being at ease with it. So our sociability, I feel I'm very sociable, but it's towards clarity. It's towards clarity that I'm very sociable. So instead of sitting in a coffee shop, you know, talking football or romance or food or whatever, right? Lifestyle. We're just sitting here talking about wow practice, right? So I could spend hours and hours just like someone else would spend at a coffee shop doing this. So this is a different type of sociability. It's Dharma sociability. So for me, like thoughts about family and friends and people, they don't arise. I don't have those thoughts. My sociability is entirely towards is practice. Because that's really where we all are anyway. No one's in a world. None of us, not one of us. Not one of us has ever been in any world at all. Or even in any realm at all, ultimately. It's impossible to leave God. There's nothing other than that God. So it's very sociable. This is really, I'm really addressing all of us the way we really are. So that's being super sociable, actually. You might say I'm super sociable instead of putting icing on the cake of arrogant sociability. Everybody agree, yeah, there's a world. I agree there's a world. Yeah, oh, touchdown. Yeah, there's a world. There's a world. And you see these people walking along and they're chit-talking. And then, oh yes, you know, that's something that, and then he said this, and he said that, he said that, and then they thought about this, and then he would act like that, but I'm not sure what he meant about that, but I think he meant like this, and then, you know, and it's like, okay. Every last little nuance of, maybe, you know, of reactions and impressions, and they're like micromanaging everybody's reactions and emotions of people, and they never stop, their minds never stop doing that. They're just obsessively saying, well, you know, what did he mean by that? I think I know what he meant by that. But, you know, like, I think I want to do this here, and I'm going to do that here. I want to see how he reacts to that. If he reacts that way to that, then I'm going to, you know, maybe I'm going to try this. But I'm not sure if that's right, because then this could arise there. But I still, and then my in-laws now, you know, they think like this and this, that. But then I have this. So it's all about family, relatives, friends, in-laws, and what they think and the reactions and how to fashion a world out of it, you know. I never think about that stuff. And people would say, well, then you can't have a civilization. Yes, you can. You can have dharmic civilization where we're super sociable. And we spend time helping one another, encouraging right practice. That's being super sociable. So it's not lesser, it's greater. It's quite steady. The rate is quite steady. We don't get these very often, this kind of event. Haven't had one like this maybe in 10 years. That's true. I wish we had them more often, especially in the wintertime. Let's have one like every couple weeks. Let's have like about 6 of them during the wintertime, and then the rest of the time, let's just have, you know, beautiful paradise here, weather-wise. Why not? Fill the reservoirs up, get everything, you know, lush and green, ground water, get that filled back up, and then have the sunshine. If it's going to storm, it might as well rain. Let it rain heavy. There's nothing worse than just clouds almost going to rain and just nothing happens. Come on. If there's not going to be any rain, then let's just have sunshine, okay? If there's going to be clouds, then let it rain. It's really easy. It's very simple. So we're just being like super sociable here. It's a great way to look at it. And I really do look at those who are not practicing, is they're being antisocial, actually. See, so people flipped it upside down on me and said that I was antisocial. I said, no, I'm totally willing. Obviously, all the videos I've made, I'm totally willing to be super sociable. It's the others, the world, those who believe in a world, that are antisocial, actually. And you can tell by their reactions is they're actually antisocial. They're ego-oriented, world-oriented, and they're insecure, and they feel threatened. And they look at other people as threats, because they think I might lose the. I feel like someone's going to take the world away from me. There's no world to take away. Well, they might take the belief in a world away from me. So you know, illusion, belief in a mirage is real. Is very threatening. It's very insecure. So the people who believe in a world are very insecure. And they're not able to really socialize in a secure way, actually. Got to have alcohol, got to have food, got to have, you know, all this kind of shuffle and dance that they all do. They can't just sit down. Let's say, let's just practice. You know, we don't need to philosophize. Let's go to Ramana, you know, and let's listen to Ramana talk. And silence, let's listen to his eloquence of silence. There's no world to talk about. There's only God to talk about, and the best way to talk about God is silence, you would say, huh? Perfect eloquence. Everything is being said equally, simultaneously and equally. That's when he meant silence, he meant actually perfect eloquence. He didn't mean something that's void. Just the opposite. Perfect fullness, perfect eloquence. All being spoken at once, because there's no world to speak to. There's no world to speak into or speak to at all. But don't philosophize about this. Just get familiar with hearing this. And so this is what's, you know, helped me so much, is I listen to Rama Maharshi, and I just keep, over and over, I keep hearing the same stuff, and just like, wow, wow, I just wow it. I listen to the Dharma King's teaching. Again, when I talk about being sociable, super sociable, I keep inviting everyone to be super sociable, and it's so difficult for everyone. Like I have this folder where I have all these pictures and quotes of Rama Maharshi. I just collected them from various places. And I then go to my screensaver and say, use content for screensaver. Choose a folder, browse. I choose that folder, Rama Maharshi pictures and quotes. And then every time it goes into screensaver mode, it just displays as a slideshow these pictures and quotes. So every day, that's when I'm not using the computer, that's what's in the room. I can just glance and see it, and then I come over and just say, oh yeah, wow, wow, wow. And I'll spend like a minute or two, or maybe 10 minutes, or maybe you know longer, but it's every day that's being reinforced all through the day. See, that's being super sociable, isn't it? Because I'm socializing with Rama Maharshi. So we need to socialize with the Dharma Kings. They're willing to do so. Sri Sri Anandamayi said, I'm willing to socialize with you. And she appeared last night in my mind's eye. She said, I'm here. I'm here. Thanks for inviting me. She's super sociable. I mean, you talk about super sociability. She's the queen of sociability, super sociability, the queen of wow, our queen of wow, Sri Sri Anandamayi. You invite her to socialize and she's there. You say, well, she's dead. What killed her? The world? There's no world. she just no longer appeared here. She withdrew her appearance from us in terms of a body appearance. But she didn't go anywhere. There's no world to leave, actually. But just our delusion is such that we wanted to keep. We wanted to think, no, it's time for you to leave the world, Ma. You know, like that. You know, time for you to leave the world. You're getting old. And she said, okay, if you don't want this body to continue to appear, it won't. But I'm not going anywhere. There's nowhere for me to go. That's true. So you ask her to socialize with you, and she's here. Literally. Literally. This isn't just some sort of vague fantasy. No, she's literally here. All the Dharma Kings are literally here. Longchamp said, if you call upon me to socialize with me, I'm here. He addressed future generations. He says, anyone who calls upon me, I will respond in an appropriate way. I am still present, absolutely present. This is true. This is absolutely true. So we have the opportunity to practice super sociability with the Dharma Kings, who are super sociable. The best. And we need practice at super sociability, because those who believe in a world are very antisocial. I mean, they really are. You could say they're sociable, but they're not super sociable at all. So we don't want to denigrate them and say, well, they're antisocial, even though it is that way. But we're trying to use gentle speech here. So they're sociable, but they're not super sociable. They refuse to socialize with the Dharma Kings. So that means they're not super sociable. They're sociable within the context of a belief in a world, which is really means they feel threatened by everything. It's hard to be really sociable when you feel threatened by everything. Any little word someone might say, oh, that threatens my worldview, you know. And that's why they don't like being around me at all. I can't find anyone who wants to be around me except the Dharma Kings and a few of you, you know. And thank you. It's wonderful. So those of us that are super sociable, we need to stick together. We really do. Because we're not going to find it elsewhere, you know. We're not. And the world is becoming, not the world, but that's just a figure of speech, but those who believe in a world are becoming very, very fanatical about it. They always have been, but now their fanaticism is being amplified. They got all these amplifiers to amplify their fanaticism. Totally weird drink here. Ah. But what can I do? It's austerity. It's austerity time. Still not losing any weight. I'm just plateaued. Just plateaued. 173. Plateaued 173. Can't seem to get down lower than that. I'm plateaued right now. That's okay. It's a 2-pound drop from 175. No. I don't know what my goal is for Inauguration Day. Certainly not more than 173. So I want to be able to make sure I hold this weight and or don't go above it for the next 2 weeks. So I'm just really into these smoothies. And I mean, there's a lot of great goodness in this. I mean, I put, for instance, I put the protein green drink. You buy in the store protein green drink. Real heavy with all this super good greenness. And then I put some coconut hydration drink in there with it. Then I put a lot of fresh blueberries in. Then I put in a whole bunch of dried cherries, a bunch of goji berries, a bunch of coconut flakes. And quite a bit of sunflower seed butter. Yeah, that's my drink. Can you believe that? It looks like mud, right? It doesn't look so good. I already drank half of it, and I've diluted the other half with water. So now it's half and half water, half drink, and that's easier to drink that way. So again, sunflower seed butter, coconut chips, goji berries, dried cherries, super protein green drink, and coconut water and blueberries. Fresh blueberries. And it tastes like meh, you know, I don't know. There's no way, sort of indescribable blandness to the taste. I have to admit that, it's bland. Which is okay. Bland is okay. I did so much core work yesterday that I'm sore. I had a hard time sleeping. My core is sore. It really is. It's just kind of aching. My whole back and core area is just aching. Paying the price for working out. You pay a price for it. really do. It's like, wow, no wonder why people stop doing it. The body complains. And it's just a matter of, you just keep doing it, but not overdoing it. If you overdo it, the body complains so much, you just feel like, ah, I gotta stop. Can we light some incense here? Oh, the wind's gonna blow it. So, we could be super sociable and still talk about food and exercise in a humorous way. In a lighthearted way. I like to have fun with the nutrition and just sort of make a, you know, kind of a little bit farcical. Get too fixated on it. I think every smoothie I make is different. I have no recipes. I just like, let me try, you know, actually, maybe later in the day I'll throw a banana in, actually. And so I have good nutrition, and then I'm always eating handfuls of walnuts. I always scoop up walnuts and eat those. And I'll have avocado, and I'll have, I didn't put protein powder in here because there's already protein in there. I'll have Greek yogurt, a lot of pecans. I eat a lot of pecans. And, you know, various nuts at times, almonds, pistachios, a lot of peanut butter. I eat a lot of peanut butter. I eat butter. I like butter also. And crackers, whole wheat crackers. And so I'm just kind of like nibbling here and there, and this, a little bit of this, and then. But I don't sit down to like, all right, here's my breakfast. Grapefruit, toast, eggs, some jam, some tea or some coffee, and then lunch and dinner. I just don't sit down and eat meals. And this sort of parallels a spiritual practice. I don't like say, okay, here's my spiritual practice for the day. It's more like I keep doing it all day. I think someone suggested, one of the Dharma kings, I believe, is like do 10 minutes intense, or just do some intense push for like 10 minutes real far, and then back off into the wow of it. And then 10 more minutes and back off into the wow. And so I kind of eat that way. And, you know, I know that's, someone's trying to disturb me here. Yeah, one second. So, everybody who believes in the world thinks they're being very sociable, but they're faking it. They're really being antisocial. Because I'm saying here, look, hey, let's socialize. They won't socialize with me. Because I'll point out, you know, that I socialize with the Dharma King. Say, no, you can't do that. You can't do that. As when I was young, I socialized with the Dharma Kings, the spiritual beings. And people said, you can't do that here. You can't do that in the world. I said, well, I'm not in the world. Well, we say you. I said, no, there's no world. Well, you're crazy. Stop socializing. It's your imagination. So they were very antisocial towards me. And I just like was totally shocked by it, you know. It's shocking to interact with those who believe in a world, believe that they're in a world. They're just spirits. They're not. There's no world to be in. But the belief system and the illusion and the mirage of a world is so strong in them. And so they demanded that I stop socializing with the Dharma kings. He said, that's a sign of crazy. You can't do that as you get older. You got to grow up in the world here. You're in a world now. I said, no, there's no world. Not in a world. What do you mean? Well, they don't know what I mean. All right. So I'm working to get back to socializing with the Dharma kings. This is very important because they're super sociable. And that helps us with our super sociability. Ooh. There's really a lot of rain up in the Sierra Nevada, the mountains. It's not really so much snow, only at the highest elevations. So this will be very interesting because there's another storm Tuesday, Wednesday. That's a cold storm from the Gulf of Alaska. It's much colder. This one's coming up from the tropics. And that's going to dump a ton of snow up on the mountains. But right now, there's a massive amount of water, rainwater, runoff water in the mountains. So what happens when... And prior, there was a big snowstorm up there. So first, there's a big snowstorm. Now, it's massive rain onto that snow that's already there, melting it. And then another snowstorm's going to come on top of that. So I'm thinking that that's going to trap the moisture up there. There's going to be a tremendous amount of moisture in the mountains this year. That's how I see it. I don't know if that's accurate as far as meteorological accuracy, but it's going to be very interesting to see how that plays out. Because they're saying, you know, as much as 6 to 10 inches of rain in the Sierra Nevada. Wow. Massive runoff from it, they're expecting. But with the snow, heavy snowstorm coming on top of it, what will that do? Will that melt the snow that's falling, or will it trap the water that's running off? I don't know how that works. We'll find out pretty soon. And people say, well, you have a body. I say, well, yeah, there's a body here. They say, well, we brought you into the world. So what do you mean? You can't bring me into what doesn't exist. There is no, you're not in a world. So how, if you're not in a world, how did you bring me into a world? There is no world. So how can you bring me into a world? That's just a belief system you're trying to bring, a false belief system you're trying to bring me into. But they didn't like that. No, there obviously is a world out there. You know, no, it's just a belief in your mind in a world. But there isn't any world. There's only mind. So that's the trouble, severe trouble, to say the least. We all have this trouble. Anyone who comes here comes into this delusional belief system and tries to help this delusional belief system runs into this trouble. It's more than trouble. It's insanity, really. And they say, well, we won't help you out with the world then. I say, well, there's no world to help me out with. Help me out with the conditions, but there's not conditions of a world. And they didn't understand that. It's like, you're weird. No, believing in what doesn't exist is weird. And they felt threatened. They see me as a threat. And so then you feel ostracized, you feel isolated, and I'd say, hey, you know, I'd love to socialize. Not at the expense of believing in a world, because that's not socialization, that's insanity. And then you're not really socializing, you're just jousting. How's the gutter? I can see it from here. Eh, no problem, it's just flowing nice and smooth. There's no... It's being very sociable, this storm, actually. You have to thank it. Hasn't caused power outages yet, knock on wood. And no down tree limbs here at all. I mean, so there's nothing wild or bad. It's just a sort of a gentle, steady rain. But other than that, it's It's a very sociable storm, you might say. That's really great. Not a deluge. And I won't get into other aspects of it right now because this is enough for us. This is enough for us. It's enough for us. Please take a survey. Whenever you do anything now, they keep sending you texts. Please take this survey. Please take this survey. I mean, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? It's all automated, just machines. Everything's machines. You're not dealing with people anymore. Talk about antisocial. Talk about producing an antisocial situation. Just bring machines into the situation, you know. Talk about trying to isolate yourself and jousty. Barricade yourself behind automation, you know. That's super antisocial. I feel that this situation, this belief system right now, is super antisocial. Social media, is that really social? Not really. It's really antisocial. Antisocial media. That's not real sociability. What we're doing here is actual social abilities, actual social interaction. It really is. So kudos to all those watching the videos. And because you are getting used to super sociability and the ability to genuinely socialize with spirit, what we are, where we are, which is in the oneness, the allness of God. So if we're arguing over that we're not where we are, is that being sociable or is it being antisocial? It's being antisocial. It's argumentative, isn't it? So even when California has a storm, it's nice. But I'm not going to go out in it. No. Let it calm down. Let it calm down first. Because weird stuff can arise. I just saw a U.S. postal truck go past. It's Sunday. What are they doing? That doesn't make any sense at all. So when it's storming, respect the storm. Like the world right now, it's going into a super antisocial phase. This is a really great way of looking at it. Really, really super antisocial phase. And so those who are very sociable, super sociable, we got to make sure that we remain in a super sociable situation and we don't get swept into being antisocial. So hanging out with very antisocial mindsets is not being super sociable at all. And we'll get out of practice. We'll get rusty. It's bad for us. So, of course, we have the right to be sociable. Who claims that we have to be antisocial? Now, so the world, those who believe in a world have it backwards. They think that they're, you know, if they say, oh, you're not hanging out with us, that means you're antisocial. No, I just don't like hanging out with the antisocial crowd because I'm very sociable. So they try to define it, you know, in an upside down, backwards way. And we have to, you know, say, no, that's a misdefinition for sure. Easily seen. Water's coming in from every angle here. Is it getting the computer wet? A little damp, maybe. Yeah, I gotta be careful here. There's mist, just moisture is kind of just drifting everywhere. It's coming down now pretty good, it looks like. Yeah, it is. Wonderful. We love it here. We love it. We pray for rain. Thank you, Pacific Ocean. But we're so spoiled. We say after this like one rain event, we say, okay, no more rain for 5 years. Turn off the faucet. No. Let's get like about 6 more of these to this year. Come on. We can wait. We can be patient. The weather outlook at the beach, not good. It's like next week, it's like wind, rain. It doesn't look very nice at all. So we had our beautiful days. October, November. And early December, in great weather. That's the best, I think, the best time for the beach in San Francisco area. The summer's foggy, cold, but it's beautiful in the autumn. Now, San Francisco in the autumn is very nice, but in the summer is. Mark Twain said, the coldest winter I ever spent was summer in San Francisco. That's true. So since there's no world, there's no barrier to the Dharma Kings at all. We keep saying world just means a barrier, really. This is where the world starts, this world ends, and out this is outside, this is inside the world, this is outside the world. You know, it's just a mental delusion, belief system. Dharma Kings aren't outside some world. There's no world for them to be outside of. So they're available to us always. So we need to keep bending our attention in this direction. Keep bending our attention in this direction. I know these are a lot of videos now, but they're very important because, again, this is intensive time. And the intensive is to practice full stop in the well. That's our practice here. Okay, so we're not going to try and please everyone. There's plenty of intensives in eye inquiry in the world, right? If you want to do eye inquiry intensive, I'm sure you can find that. But there's a lack of intensives for this wow practice for those who really are love just the beauty and the sublime. And what the practice really is you're practicing super sociability by full stop on the wow, which cancels out our thoughts searching for a world. The belief that there's these thoughts, that the world is generating these thoughts. There's no world generating any thoughts. It's our desire for a world that's generating the thoughts. Now, when you believe in the world and want there to be a world, you will find you generate this deities in your out of your own imagination and place them at a higher level, the highest level of this imaginary world. And then you imagine they're inspiring you to create the world, to make the world, or make it better, to learn how to live in the world, you know. So they become your god and goddess. Oftentimes it's the goddess that we use. These are just figments of our imagination to try and motivate us to keep believing in a world. This is what I discovered. I went through all of this, checked the belief in a world. I said, what's going on? Why are they so attached to it? Well, because they're following the goddess, the Virgin Mary, as many follows. You know, my children, you are God placed you here in the world as this beloved, special, chosen children to, you know, be fruitful and multiply and fill the world with happiness and joy and children and love and laughter. And we want you to be, you know, very good human beings and all this kind of, you know, this is it's completely made up. It's just imaginary. We just imagine there's these deities instructing us of how to be good citizens of a world. It's a play of our imagination. Yet it seems it's very strong, because we think, you know, we conjure up these deities that come advise us about how to function as a citizen of a world. And I say, don't worry, God created worlds. God created you humans, as bodies, humans, to live in a world. And yes, you're a human being, but you also have a spirit, and your spirit is for the purpose of glorifying God by glorifying the world. You know, this is all made up stuff, totally made up, out of our own wishful thinking. It's just our own wishful thinking and imagination. But those who believe this, it seems so powerful to them that they're, you know, they, of course they make up, like, if you go against God, you got, you know, the God's instructions for a world, you'll be punished. God will be angry with you. That's also completely made up. There's a made up angry